Hello students, welcome to Noble Digital class. We look forward to your utmost attention and dedication towards your class at your Noble platform. Using of technology in excess may be harmful for your physical and mental health. To reduce its aftermath, yoga and meditation is recommended. Students should practice these regularly. Please watch the video for 30 to 40 minutes only. Then take 5 to 10 minutes break. Close your eyes and recall the content taught by your teacher. This short break will be quite relaxing for your eyes.
Hello students, last time we had got the explanation of the chapter The Enemy, and I hope you might have got your whole attention reverted to that particular part of the exposition so far. I think page number 30 was going on, and Dr. Salau was all set, okay, to start the surgery of the POW to get the bullet out of his body, which was lying at the right side, the lower back of the enemy's body. Before that, let me put some sort of flashback part of the particular chapter to own your understanding about the particular chapter. You see, the story is set amidst the Second World War time, in the backdrop of the Second World War, when a POW from America has washed ashore at the Japanese sea coast outside of a Japanese doctor, Dr. Sadao, who was a very prominent, very eminent, a very distinguished, the first rated doctor and the scientist and the surgeon of the country, Japan. It was fortunate or unfortunate, okay, it varies person to person. Fortunate when we talk about the enemy's perspective, because he has washed away in front of a doctor who was a champion when it comes to surgery of a patient who was in death throes. And unfortunate in point of view of Dr. Sadao, because Japan was at war with America, or in such times, or if an enemy has washed away to your door, obviously a person must get carried away by a lot of sentiments or the emotions towards their motherland, and obviously must be driven by the spirit of patriotism or the spirit of jingoism, love for your country, respect for your country, compare the person to hand him over to the army or to the police. But you see, what was the ultimate decision, okay, taken by Dr. Sadao? The story remarkably presents the fix confronted by Dr. Sadao. Now let me get the journey ahead of it. Dr. Sadao and Hana, after a long discussion or the deliberation, all set to get an operation or the surgery go. And now Dr. Sadao so far was in a particular room to get his whole medical paraphernalia to be collected in his emergency bag or the medical bag, so that during the course of surgery, okay, he will be using, he will be needing each and everything, okay, will be lying there at his hand there. Let us resume the journey from page 30. I'm proceeding forward. I will tell him what you see, Hana replied courteously there. Now let me tell the introduction of these particular lines. Now, when the three servants of Sadao's home, who are those three servant children? Let me put into your notice again, the old gardener who had been working there, who had been at Sadao's home till the time of his childhood. Then comes Yumi, the maid servant, the babysitter for the two children of Sadao and Hana. And obviously the third one was the cook. And you see, obviously the reaction lost by those three servants was almost normal and very much spontaneous there. When it comes to the love towards country, respect to your motherland, obviously nothing is bigger than that of your nation, than that of your country. When it comes to wartime, wartime is only the time where every person of a country is all committed, okay, towards his or her country, and is absolutely ready to show his or her patriotism whenever it is needed, okay. Even they won't hesitate, the people, okay, to sacrifice themselves on the altar of motherland, okay. So when those three servants came to know the very presence or the arrival of POW at their home, okay, they didn't like it. They were agitated. They were very much annoyed. They were very much, very much furious at the decision taken by their honor, taken by their master, Sadao and Hana. So at the back of Sadao, they were showing their grievances. They were speaking loudly, purposefully, so that Hana, who was standing few yards away from them, can listen to them and can transmit and can tell, reveal the same content to her husband Sadao, that whatever decision they have taken to shelter an enemy and to operate an enemy was an anti-national decision. They must not have done that. So when Hana heard the grievances, the louder, intentional louder words spoken by those servants purposefully, she understood the entire matter. And now how she is reacting to the grievances or the grudges of all these servants, check it out. I will tell him what you say, Hana said back, reverted back to the servants. Okay, you don't feel bothered and agitated, dear. Whatever your grievances, I will surely tell the entire stuff to my husband, Sadao, your master. Hana replied courteously. Generally, the mistress is not supposed to speak courteously, politely, meekly, gently, when it comes to the servants. But because she knew that she was at wrong foot, they have decided something anti-national stuff. Therefore, her tone was very much meek, very much gentle while talking with her servants. But she herself was also frightened by the agitated reaction, by the furious reaction when she witnessed the servants were all set, okay, to have a rebel against them. She was frightened, she was scared, okay. Although she was not superstitious, as the old man was gardener. Old man here was gardener. And what statement of old gardener, okay, spoken in the chapter, which justifies that he was a superstitious man? When he said that the master ought not do that thing when the Japanese sea wanted to take the life of the POW, when the sea rocks wanted to take the life of the POW, when the Japanese bullet wanted to take the life of this particular man, the POW from America, our master, the master, Dr. Sadao, should have followed the same. But he was actually doing the work to save his life of the POW. That was obviously against the deeds done by the Japanese bullet, Japanese sea, and the Japanese sea rocks. But when those three things will see that Dr. Sadao has done something against them, who knows, they can take a revenge, they can take an avenge upon Dr. Sadao. But Hana didn't believe in such orthodox stuff, such a superstitious stuff, that how it is possible for the sea rocks or the ocean to take a revenge upon Dr. Sadao. Though she didn't believe, but still she knew that they were right on their part. And they were, all three servants were right on their part, because they were standing by the nation. And obviously nothing is bigger than that of your nation, especially when it comes to wartime. Superstitious, the old man, the gardener was, could it ever be well, to help an enemy? How? The act of saving or sheltering or helping an enemy can be justified during wartime. Next to impossible. That was a horrendous decision. That was a heinous deed whatsoever taken by or decided by them to be done. That they have decided to cure, give a surgery, try to save the life of the enemy through a surgery. That was not the way to deal with an enemy, especially during wartime. Nevertheless, however, or we can use it still there, warm there, nevertheless, nonetheless, however, she told you me to fetch the hot water and bring it to the room where the white man was there. And as the things were communication or the deliberation between servants and Anna got stopped there, now it was Yumi's turn to pass an order to Yumi. It was Hana's turn to pass a command to Yumi that she was supposed to fetch a hot water there, a bucket of hot water, so that the body of the POW before the operation starts can be sterilized, can be put germ-free there, or no bacteria whatsoever could be there, should be there on his body if the surgery is underway. Now Yumi was asked to fetch to go and bring. What she was supposed to fetch, go and bring, that was a bucket of hot water for the washing of the POW's body before surgery takes place. She went ahead and slid back the partition, and now she, obviously Hana, went ahead of Yumi, who was fetching the hot water bucket in her hand there, and obviously she slid the partition, removed the partition of the room so that both of them can enter into that room. And mind you, which room is referred here? The room of Sadao's father, because after the death of Sadao's father, or the demise of Sadao's father, the room was lying absolutely empty, or obviously there was no one to use it. Therefore they have shifted, they have placed the unconscious body of Mr. POW in that particular room, and both of the women were going to that room where POW's unconscious body was lying there and ready for wash. She went ahead and removed the partitions. Sadao was not yet there, and when she reaches there, she found Sadao was still out of that particular room. Yumi, following her, put down a wooden bucket. Then she went over the white man. When she saw him, her thick lips folded and set into stubbornness there. Yumi has got no idea that who was the man who is going to be cured, who is going to be operated by the master. She has got no idea whatsoever. But when she reaches, when she put down the bucket, and then she witnessed, then she observed the face of that man, unconscious man, she came to know, she realized, oh my God, he happens to be a white man, an American. Happens to their enemy, perpetual enemy, all Americans are for all Japanese. So looking at the face, after realizing the fact that the man was an American, their enemy, Yumi, the lips of Yumi got absolutely folded in stubbornness. Angry she was, furious she was, adamant. Stubbornness, adamant she became, obstinate she became, determined she became, resolute she became, that she won't touch, she would not wash the wound of this particular POW or the enemy. And obviously it is the very duty or the responsibility of every person during wartime to show their loyalty, to show their faithfulness, to show their honesty, to show their love and respect for the country. If they can't fight a battle, at the battlefield, at least they can preserve, they can conserve, they can safeguard the sovereignty, the integrity of the nation at least there. So looking at the face of the POW, she realized, Yumi, the med servant, realized that he happens to be her enemy, and obviously she straight off declined, denied, refused Anna that she is not gonna to wash him there at all. And even the lips of Yumi got folded in absolute resolution, absolute adamancy that she won't touch the body of POW. To the white man, when she saw him, thick lips folded themselves here, the lips got folded automatically into adamancy, resolution, determination. I have never washed a white man, she said, Yumi said to Hana, and I will not wash so dirty one noun there. So she obviously showed her grievances, she showed her grisses, she showed her inability, okay, to wash that, okay, and she stayed upset on the face of Hannah, ostensibly that, okay, Hannah, the mistress, I have never washed such a person in my entire life, and I keep, okay, myself, okay, with the same resolution that I won't touch here also today. So I never did this task before, and I am thinking not to do right now also. It means she was a defiant, disobeying the command, the order of the mistress Hannah. Or you see, it is the usual tendency when a master or a mistress comes to know that their servant openly defiant them, disobeying them. No master, no mistress ever would be liking that stuff there. So see the reaction of Hannah when Yumi declined, denied, okay, defied, okay, Hannah's command to wash the body of Mr. POW. Yumi following, okay, into stubbornness, okay, want to, Hannah cried at her severely, and the sooner Hannah came into a great fury, and she was scolding, she was shouting severely at rigorously, at stringently at the servant, Yumi, the babysitter. And what word she used while scolding Yumi? You will do what your master commands you. Don't you understand that it is the order, it is the instruction of your master, your honor, and you are supposed to follow the same there. Don't you have the simple mannerism to follow? How you can defy me openly in that manner? Okay, do what I say. So the tone was authoritative, the tone was domineering, as every mistress, every master does it there at a regular basis. But let me tell you dear, that this time Yumi was not in a mood, okay, to get subdued, okay, in front of the mistress there. And I already told you that nothing is bigger than that of your national security and the patriotism there. And when it comes to show your real guts during war time there, obviously Yumi was a servant. She was well paid off by Hannah, undoubtedly. But when it comes to the sovereignty, integrity, security of a nation, obviously there was no match there. So now you will see the changing of the tone of Hannah. Right now she may be sounding a bit authoritative or domineering, but the moment she saw the indifferent attitude, the furious attitude, or the reaction or response of Yumina, see the changing tone of Hannah. I am Hannah cried severely, you will do what your master commands you. There was so fierce, violent, a look of resistance upon Yumi's round, dull face. Dull face here, having no gesture, having no emotions on the face. Okay, indifferent face was there, round face of Yumi, has got no emotion, no gesture on her face. But a violent gesture was there, okay, on the face, or even in the eyes, there was a fire, there was a spark. Hannah could see it out of her naked eyes. Or when Hannah witnessed that the spark of resistance, the spark of fury in the eyes of Yumi, Hannah could not sustain that. And see the reaction of Hannah at that. The face of Hannah felt unreasonably afraid. She got terrified. So you are witnessing here that first time the mistress Hannah got terrified of a servant's reaction. And what type of reaction Yumi gave to Hannah back there? The resistance was so furious that the spark of the anger was that much enormous in the eyes of Yumi. Hannah didn't find herself comfortable enough, okay, to survive that particular thing. So instantly she took a U-turn, authoritative her tone was, and the next moment when she saw the fury, the wrath, okay, in the eyes of Yumi, let us see what happened next. Okay, report something, look of the unreasonable friend. After all, why the tone of Hannah became absolutely nimble there, meek or gentle there, subdued there, soft there? Why? Because if the servant should report something that was not as it happened there. obviously, the, when we talk about our first glimpse at the site or at the case that Dr. Rao all said or all decided to operate the POW. So first impression will be that, very understandable that, oh my God, an enemy, is going to be saved by Dr. Sadao. Obviously, it was an anti-national deed, indeed. So, or if the same case is reported by the servants to the army or to the police, now, obviously, it was a sheer case of treachery against the nation, and obviously, no government would be taking it lightly. Therefore, God, a bit gentle or very much, what you can say, meek in a tone while talking to Yumi. Very well, she said, with dignity, not respect, is all shown by Hana towards Yumi. And Yumi, if you don't want to wash this POW, no problem. You please get on your work. You take care of the two kids there. They are waiting for you. Respect was shown by Hana to Yumi. Okay, dignity, you understand. We only want to bring him to the census so that we can turn him over as a prisoner of war. And no need to underestimate or misunderstand our attack or our stand. You mean, let me open up, disclose each and what is our plan regarding this particular case there. This is POW for you. This is POW for us. This is an enemy for you. This is enemy for us there. There's no difference whatsoever in our mind as far as this stupid man is concerned. And I promise you, the moment he gets conscious again, he becomes conscious again, promise we will be handing over to the police there. So we are just waiting for the time he gets conscious, he becomes conscious. Once he will be on his feet, promise we will be handing over him to the police, to the army, as a POW, prisoner of war, as a true Japanese, as a true Japanese there. So no need to have any doubt, that we are helping an enemy, or no need to have that sort of comprehension or that sort of understanding, or to form an opinion that we, your master, are all set to help an enemy during wartime. We are true Japanese like you all are. Hana, disclosed and put forward openly her stand or her opinion about the presence of POW and what was the plan going on in the mind of Hana and Sadao. She revealed it in front of Yumi so that she may not misunderstand their decision as anti-national. Then please, Hana said gently, return to your own work. And then Hana asked Yumi, go back to her job. That was to look after the two kids, the two children of Sadao and Hana. At once Yumi left the room, and the moment Hana allowed Yumi to leave the room, instantly she hastened out of the room. She hurried herself off out of the room. She went very fast out of the room. She might have been too afraid to stay had not been. But this left Hana with the white man all alone. She might have been too afraid to stay had not been anger at Yumi's stubbornness, resolution, determination. Now sustained her, survived her, sustained her, survived her, sustained her, survived her. And now, you see, when Yumi left the room, what it did again, it has done something obnoxious for Hana. Now, Sadao was in his room preparing for the surgery himself in another room. Yumi has recently left. Now only two people left in that room. One was the POW and second was Hana. And Hana too was a true Japanese there. She didn't want to sustain in that place where the body of POW was lying there close to her. So, but she could not leave the room instantly, because had he left the room, how it is possible for the mistress Hana to justify this act of sheltering an enemy was a fair one there. And how she could ask the servants to wash the wound of this particular POW if she could not stand with that particular person. How she can expect from the servants to go further than that. So this is the only reason why Hannah had to sustain in that room, because before a minute or two she had scolded Yumi for not doing that particular favor to Mr. POW. Or if she herself would quit the room, Yumi has got every right to disobey, to defy the order of their mistress Hannah. Therefore, in order to prove her decision correct and the reaction of Yumi was not up to the mark, she decided to be there in the room, not to leave it. Willingly? No, she wasn't really thinking. She was not really liking to stay there. She stayed there unwillingly. To what? To justify her decision was fair enough in front of all three servants. Otherwise, she herself would have quit earlier than Yumi, if you talk about a real wish, okay, of Anna's heart. Sustain her. Okay, dear, enough for today. Next class will be